1, 2. Mic test 1, 2. Mic test 1, 2.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. We're gonna make it a nice relaxed evening, so that if you haven't got some food yet, or at any point you want some food, or you want a range of juices or some water, then feel free to stand up and go and get it. You won't feel like you're interrupting anything. We'll all be fine with that. We'll all be doing that. So first thing to say is just a big welcome to GB Met in Brighton. Thank you for coming. Thank you especially for the panel and the speakers we've got tonight that I think they've got some very exciting things to share with us from their experience. Thank you all for the questions that you've given us in advance that we're going to be discussing with the panel. There's going to be a chance to ask questions from the floor as well if you haven't had a chance to submit anything online. And I am convinced that we will go away, maybe not any clearer as to what's going to happen in the future, re-digital education, but definitely with some serious food for thought. So I'm going to hand over to Jim Lee, who works at GB Met in Brighton in film and digital media, one of our tutors, and he has been one of our pioneers in terms of running with technology, especially with Google Apps for Education, and kind of that's transformed the way that he and his team, and then it's filtering out as it is from all sources to the rest of us in the college in terms of how we can assess teaching and make the life of the teacher potentially easier, and make the life of the student or the program they're studying, make that more enriched, and kind of changing the way of teaching and learning at the same time, which I'm sure we all know about. So I'm going to hand over to Jim, and then later on, the panel are going to introduce themselves. They're going to speak to you for kind of 10 minutes each and give you, they'll introduce themselves and they'll give you a 10-minute presentation that will definitely make you think. And we will then go to the panel discussion. And like I say, please don't be rooted to your seat thinking, I need the toilet or I need a drink, but I can't possibly move because it's not a formal occasion. Okay, over to you, Jim.
Okay, thanks, Martin. I'm not going to say much. Talk about what it means to me personally about tonight and the project we've been doing this year and this kind of rolling plan we have to kind of transform our teaching and learning to a more cloud-based, connected practice. It's always struck me as interesting that one of the definitions of the word academic is it's pointless, meaningless, or out of touch with reality. And I think maybe if you went to the school I did in the 1970s, you might have come to the same conclusion. But I ended up here doing teacher training many decades later. Well, two or three decades later, I'm not quite that old. But my research study for my teacher training was on the learning theory of connectivism. It's quite a modern theory. And it's not a very big theory. It's quite simple, really. It's about how learning exists in people and things and organizations, and by making connections between those things and by developing those connections, you can enhance and increase and change the way people learn and organizations learn. So it's interesting. I know tonight there are people here from a lot of different organizations, not just normal schools and colleges and universities, but also people from the private sector. And I think it'd be interesting if we can explore particularly how we can put these things together and learn new things in different ways as different organizations. So please talk to me afterwards if you've got any ideas about that. But one of the ideas that's coming up, you see the leaflets around the Teach Meet that we're going to do here in January. You've all got one on your seat. We originally planned to do this event as a kind of combined Teach Meet and talk, but it kind of became that we realized we were trying to do two things too many. Well, one thing too many. And we decided we'd have a flavour of the Teach Meet tonight, for those of you who haven't been to one, and then the rest of the evening will be the panel discussion. We got a great panel of speakers. We've all got really interesting, very different things to talk about. So the first person I'm going to introduce, and this is part of what's kind of really helped me recently, is just how easy it is to make connections online, particularly. When we moved here to the Google Apps for Education, and going through the training and using that, starting to use Google Plus, which had never seemed very interesting to me or anyone else before. I think it had not a particularly great rival to other social media, but going on there, we discovered there were networks of Google educators that are unofficial ones. So we were lucky tonight to have the first speaker who's going to talk about how he's been connecting people internationally. He's the leader of the UK Google Educator Group, and he's based in Worthing, is Andy Cooper. So if you wanted to come and do our first talk.
Good evening. I'm just going to get my presentation started. As Jim quite rightly put, I'm the leader of the GEG UK, so the Google Educator Group for the UK. I took over that role last year from somebody with a lot more experience on it than me. But between us, there's like a whole group of us on there. We're active on there. It's a bit like social media. It's not quite as exciting as seeing somebody's lunch on Twitter, or finding out what somebody's daughter's doing on Facebook. But it's really good for asking people for help, or for connecting people, or for talking about things that you've tried, or does anybody have a solution for? And there's a great group of people on there. Some of them have been using Google Apps for many years, and some are just starting out and want to know how to do simple things. And it's a really good community. We've got about 2,500 members at the moment, and it's growing all the time. My personal background. So I started using Google Apps about 4 years ago when my school converted, and Google Apps had just started coming out. And over the last couple of years, I've done all of the online training, almost all of the online training that Google offer for free, sat some exams, so I'm a Google educator. I then did the Google Trainer exam as well. So I know quite a bit about the apps themselves, but they keep evolving. So you have to keep on top of what they're doing and talk to people who use it all the time too. Whilst I did the training, I discovered that actually I could talk to other educators in other parts of the world. So my school is a tiny little school in the middle of West Sussex. Well, it's not a small school, we've got nearly 2,000 students, but it's in the middle of the countryside. Our ethnic diversity is less than 1%. So we have a lot of British white people in our school. So I thought, okay, I want to break this, because a lot of our students, their sort of area of friends exists within about 10 miles, and that's kind of it. So I decided to start looking at global classrooms. How can I connect internationally? And part of the training within the Google Educator showed me the Google community, so the Google Plus. But there's communities in all parts of the world. So most countries around the world have a community. So why did I want to go global? Well, our world is getting smaller. Actually, once we've left leafy Billingshurst and gone into the real world and got a job, we're going to find people from diverse backgrounds. We're going to find people who aren't born and bred British. We're going to find people who have traveled for work or have emigrated or whatever. And we're going to come across people that will have different opinions to ourselves. I wanted to learn about stuff around the world directly from the horse's mouth rather than a book, or rather than just from reading stuff without actually speaking to people in those countries. And the best thing was, it was free to do all my connecting to all the schools I've done, and I'll show you what I've done. It was absolutely free to do. Okay. So the start of my journey. My second year at the World, I went to Kenya. We have a lovely trip that we run with our sixth form. We go to Kenya and we build classrooms. So we instill education in communities where education is really difficult. Women's education is a big part of the charity work out there. But we go out every year, we build two or three double classrooms to help educate the local communities. So whilst we're out in Kenya, we would ask the students their aspirations, their family life, their school life, information that we wanted to share with our year 7s and 8 kids. Paper-based, I'm a math teacher, so it kind of fitted in with data handling, which was perfect for me. But it was laborious. Once you've spoken to 100 kids and got responses to 25 questions, all of a sudden, all of that's got to be inputted somewhere and analyzed and copied. It was a little bit laborious. So it absolutely needed modernizing. So That was my plan. I picked all this up from the Google suite of tools. Okay, international collaboration, so I used the Google Plus communities. I connected with schools, and I'll show you my map in a minute, all over the world. I wanted to do some group work within my lessons. I wanted kids to work with each other, because kids don't like working with each other, to do some maths. Sorry if you don't like maths, tough. I wanted to do some hypothesis testing. So first thing I said to the kids was, all right, we're going to talk to some schools in America. We're going to talk to some schools in Mexico. We're going to talk to some schools in Tanzania, was one of our countries as well. What are your expectations of the things you're asking? What do you expect the kids to say to you about where do they go on holiday? And things like that. So they had to start thinking about their preconceptions. Collecting the data. So Google Forms, really beautiful for collecting data. It's a lovely tool. Using Google Sheets to analyze it was brilliant. Put it all together in a presentation in their little groups. So within their little groups within each class, they had to present it in slides. And then where we had an opportunity to do a video hangout, we did. So we actually physically connect, well, not physically, but video called the schools and actually introduced each other. And some of the classes did their slides online directly with the kids in those other countries, which was awesome. Oh, you can't see the map. That's really sad. I'll give you a little flavor. So where all the big dots are on the left, that is North America. There's the next one down, which is Mexico, school down in Rio. This little house is a Catholic school in Australia. There's a few in Africa, and then we've got some in Europe and Russia as well. So I connected 500 kids at my school, so two whole year groups. We did the whole 2 year groups, year 7 and 8, with a class in at least one of each of those schools around the world. So we had nearly 1,000 students talking to each other that would never have met before. And it was really learning centered for the kids. Something that they really picked up on was the first question. They said, are we really going to talk to these kids in other parts of the world? Are we really getting data, or is it just going to get made up? That was the first thing. And I said, well, have a look at your form when it comes back and see when it was put in. See where it's come from. Engagement with technology. So we're talking about technology. We're talking about learning with technology. And they had to. Most of the kids had some of the skills, but I was really surprised at what they didn't know. Change of viewpoint. So this comes back to my hypothesis testing. And so things we've done since my project. We've spoken to some schools in America before the last presidential election. We've spoken to a school in Rio about the run-up to the Olympics before the Olympics were in Rio the other year. And we wanted to talk to the kids rather than finding out everything from like the BBC or what we've seen in the press and the news. And actually the viewpoints are really different. The case in point would have to be the lovely new president of America, which everybody loves, of course. We were quite candid with the teachers and the kids out there. Why are you voting for this businessman? And they said, because he's a businessman. Our economy, our jobs, and our workforce are not doing very well, and we need somebody who can fix it, not somebody who's going to keep it going as it was, which is why they elected the lovely Mr. Trump. New friends, this was really, really exciting. So the schools that we met and we did video chats with, we got pictures of, and they said hello, and some of the kids are still in contact via social media. So we let them branch out into Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, and just given them some guidelines about how to use that sensibly. But these are a couple of the schools that that we connected with in America. Things we're going to do next year. So my plans for next year. So we've done a nice project before. We've now got quite a few Chromebooks. So we're going to be using Chromebooks in class. The kids instinctively now know how to use them, which is just amazing. We're having a global hangout day. So I've spoken to my schools and I said around the world, I said, we're just going to open up a hangout chat as a group in our library. And we're going to have the kids come in, post questions, stay for a few minutes, have a conversation, a dialogue. And it's just open and it will be monitored, but actually the kids will have free reign to talk about what they want to talk about and what they want to ask. So that's kind of, it's a huge experiment, a bit of a risk. That's all right, we'll give it a go. Video messaging, we didn't do any of that. And we missed out on a school in Alaska because unfortunately time zones really don't allow you to have a live chat. We did have a few in America where we came in for, the kids stayed at school late. They phoned their parents and said, can you pick me up at 6 o'clock because I want to stay and do this. And the kids in the States were coming in for breakfast at 7 o'clock in the morning because they wanted to do the same. They want to chat. They want to meet other people. So video messaging is something next. And geography, history, and design technology actually are coming together, and we're going to do a project with other subjects as well. So it's not just about maths and collecting data. Actually, you can do lots of cool learning stuff with other subjects too. And the exciting thing is the first school I started with in the middle of Missouri in the States, we've actually got a physical student exchange that we're running. So 12 of their students are coming to my school for 10 days, and in October next year, I'm taking 12 students back to the States for 10 days. So that's really exciting. So we've taken the digital, and we've actually made some friends, and we're going to, you know, turn it into real. Can you guys do it? Can you do it in what subjects you're teaching or delivering? Yes, you can. Google Communities, you can find schools all over the world really easily. Google Forms, you can collect any data. You can collect pictures. You can upload files now. It's really, really straightforward to put together. You can connect with Google Hangouts to connect your classes together. So every time I do a video hangout with a school, I have a chat with the teacher first, and I get to know them. You can do it. Spend 10 minutes making me. And the kids love me. They love all my little bitmojis I've got stuck around my classroom. It's kind of funny. Okay, a couple of things I didn't expect. Student engagement, they loved it. They wanted to do more, and they still want to do more. When can we next connect with is a question I get all the time. Key skills. Some kids really don't know how to use a word processor. They come into secondary school, and you think, that's okay, they've got, you know, they use technology in primary schools, and actually they don't. They use video editing, fine, they make cartoons, they can make stories. They don't know how to use things like Google Docs, Word, or spreadsheets at all. So that was something that I was really surprised at. Video hangout excitement. 32 kids sitting in a room with one video camera, one microphone. You can imagine it doesn't work very well the first few times. Believe me, it doesn't. And you have to just keep reminding the kids that nobody can hear you because you're all talking at once. The subsequent social interactions with students and staff has been brilliant. So the school that we're doing a physical exchange with, I hosted the teacher for a couple of days in my house over the summer. So he's come over with his wife. He's going to stay at mine when they do the actual exchange in June, which is just amazing. It was really easy to put together. 2 days. Got me 9 schools internationally. Within 2 weeks, I had the schools on the map, and I had connections with classes in, I can't remember, 11 countries, I think. It was brilliant and easy to put together. Really, really easy. And I didn't expect to gain some new friends that are teachers in other parts of the world, who I talk to on a very regular basis, which is just awesome. I've really gone over, I'm sure, my 5 minutes, but that's okay. That's me. Obviously, that's me at the bottom as well. If you want to ask, or if you want some guidance, or if you want some connections, if you want to speak to me about, have you got a school in so-and-so that I can connect with? Yeah, I don't mind sharing, and neither do they. But if you have any questions, feel free to ask. That's me.
Well, I'm going to quickly move on. Thanks so much for that, Andy. And the next talk is from Ben Rouse, who's a trainer who works in cloud-based training, and he's going to talk about challenges of professional development. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Hi there. When I got introduced as a trainer, I kind of thought, what trainer would I be? Because I watched a documentary about Tinker Hatfield the other day, so it got me, I've got slightly distracted. Just while I get myself in to my presentation, I was a teacher for a reasonable amount of time, 13 years, but then from August the 31st was my last official day when I could say I was a teacher, and then since then I've not been. So it's been an interesting journey. But I'll get this presentation laid up, and then I'll talk to you a bit more about that. Voila. Yes, I am going to talk about professional development. I'll give you a slight bit of history. So I'm a maths teacher by trade. So, I don't know who did the bookings, but I'm sorry. I was a maths teacher for a long time. I did a master's and then became a head of maths. I did my master's in parental engagement, so I hadn't quite caught the technology bug at that point. And then it was shortly after that, I was lying around on the sofa when I had my new baby, so about 6 years ago now, and he was sleeping, thank God, and I just sort of had my phone in my hand and thought to myself, maybe Twitter's not just a footballer telling me what he's had for his breakfast. So I had a little snoop around, and I discovered that there was a fairly vibrant group of teachers. I've discovered over the last 6 years that there's also a group of teachers who will tell you when you've done something pedagogically wrong. But aside from that, there was this thriving group of people who were happy to share. But what I noticed was they kept on sharing these links to documents I could just jump straight into. And that was kind of the beginning of me discovering technology for my classroom. So I started using my Gmail account to create Google Forms, which Andy mentioned, and do some collaborative docs. And then since then, through Head of Maths, I ended up becoming a Google trainer. So that's what I do now. I go around, I work with schools who are looking to embed G Suite, which I tried to do with a number of schools over the last few years. So I've seen sort of professional development challenges in those schools. I would put on a session which would be learn how to use a Google form. In my own school, three people would turn up. But during the last 3 years, I've been invited to other people's schools where I even now I get paid to go to their schools and deliver a session on a Google form. And it was only over the last couple of years that I stopped delivering those sessions on a tool, and I switched it around. And this is why the screen says design thinking. I stopped talking about the tool, and I started finding problems worth solving. And when you find a problem worth solving, this technology that we kind of feel is probably got a place in learning in the future, but it's a hard change for a lot of organizations, educational organizations particularly, to take that technology on and find a way to use it most effectively. We've got an education system, by and large, which hasn't changed hugely over the last 100 or so years. There are bits on the peripheries doing amazing things. There are individual teachers, lecturers, educators in classrooms doing amazing things, connecting across the world. Oh, actually, Rhett Oldham was the name of the teacher Andy connected with. I saw Rhett do a chat via Hangout to Andy. The best quote I've ever heard was he was talking, this teacher from Missouri, about doing a hangout where his class came in early in the morning before school in order to do this hangout. And Rhett said, would the students come in at 6 a.m. for your best lesson? I know what the answer was. but there's the gauntlet that's set down by that kind of idea about using technology, not for the sake of it, but because it provided an opportunity for learning. The students didn't mind coming into school early, or in other scenarios, staying late. And I think that's the challenge we've got, is finding a use of technology that supports learning in a way that learning is just an appetite that young people have, old people have, everyone has. That we don't have to have a timetable, we don't have to have certain structures to it, because people are just fervently trying to track it down. So I'll just quickly talk about design thinking. Does anyone know the term and use the process or culture? Okay, so all you do, you are aware of it, you just didn't know it was called this. There's a lot of stuff like that. You know the search bar at the top of Chrome? It's called the Omnibox. Who knew? So there's a few things out there. The thing about design thinking is, often in organisations I've worked with, there's a rush to the ideas. I was walking down the corridor today, saw this problem, let's come up with ideas. And 10 minutes later, the most prominent person in the room's idea is then going to be put into policy. Or the flip side is, someone has toiled away for several months on their idea, built it up, and then launched it in front of you in all the glory of maybe a PowerPoint presentation, slides, handouts in front of you, maybe even a model. And then they go, so what do you think of my idea? And you're like, well, I'm not saying anything because I know you spent hours on it. So design thinking is this wonderful culture and set of tools that you can use to focus on empathy first. So understand. Understand the situation that you find yourself in. Never a good presentation without a Johnny Bravo quote. That's something I think teachers probably understand as much as anyone else in the world, about empathizing with the situation you're in. But just to give you a few practical ones, when I started teaching, I was asked to shadow a student. It was the most exhausting day of my whole teaching career, and trust me, I've had some exhausting ones. My school from last year, I just had a message telling me that they've got Ofsted tomorrow, so I remember exhausting days, and I'm quite pleased that, anyway. Have you shadowed anyone recently? Have you shadowed a colleague or a student or anyone in the organisation that you can possibly get your hands on and followed their day through? That's where you'll find some of the pain points, the barriers, the challenges that maybe why they haven't switched the way that they're learning or switched the way that they're teaching. A practical way of doing that is empathy maps. So as you walk around with this person, follow them through their day, you can write furiously in what they see, what they think, what they feel, what they do. And this kind of thing is what can be plastered up, whether it be in the staff area or a public area in the organisation. So people can walk by and go, oh, I never thought of it like that. Grab a post-it note, write their feelings about it. So it's that data collection around your organisation, but not in a spreadsheet, in a more practical way, to gather that empathy. That link will take you to a load of empathy maps if you would like some. I've made a few and you're welcome to use them. It's about turning challenges into questions. So on Monday, I'm going to be working with a group of leaders from Welsh schools, and around their challenges, one person is going to talk and everyone else is going to furiously write how might we statements on post-it notes. So we'll start with a general term and then we'll turn those specific challenges into questions. And it's only once you've found those challenges that you can then start to find the themes that maybe you weren't aware of before. That superficial problem in the corridor might actually be stemming from something much more important and systemic that you can then start to focus on. And that's once you've got the focus on, these are the particular areas we need to focus on, then you can start with the ideas. So what's happened with the last few years with technology is that by not focusing on the tool, but by finding problems worth solving, the tool sorted themselves out. When the school that I was working with wanted to find out about the opinions of staff because they discovered a problem, a Google form lent itself to the situation quite easily, and no one had any qualms about learning how to use a Google form. So that's really my reflections on what learning might look like in the future. This design thinking process goes on. It's worth noting, by the way, in terms of ideas, the concept of a brainstorm was kind of shown to not be very effective in 1957. So you might want to stop doing them. The reason is that people are very good at coming up with ideas when they have time and a bit of quiet. After that point, when people have had time to process their own ideas, it's like going for a walk or standing in the shower. That's where I have my best ideas. Thank God there's no one else there at the time, for them more than anyone else. But brainstorming, be careful with the term and be careful with the process. You have great ideas by yourself, but then you can bounce them around with other people after that. So 100 ideas in 10 minutes is a great way to come back together as a group and start pushing people out of having sensible, easy ideas and try and get them to have a few crazy ones too. And then you can pick the ones that you want to take forward. And prototyping. You know, I said about that precise process someone had done. This is my idea. I've taken a month to prepare it for you. What do you think? In design thinking, the prototyping is meant to be very quick. So you can take a sketchy idea out to people immediately and go, see this? What do you think? And because it's not taking you that long, people are going to be honest with you. Well, this is wrong and this is wrong. I like this bit though. And that's where you can get some valuable feedback that you can act upon. So the prototyping process is really important, and test early. throw another one, throw another one, throw another one. Find out what's working before you go for it. And then you can pitch those ideas knowing that you've probably got rid of the stuff that's going to waste your time and you can focus on the things that you want. The design thinking process needs to be a long-term thing. So me doing it in this amount of time is ridiculous. But it, for me, has been something that I'm going to take forward, whether it's student projects or school organisational change. It's got a place for it for me, and that's where I'm trying to develop technology, is through this finding problems. Thank you very much. That wasn't too easy.
Okay, thanks, Ben. And hopefully Ben and Andy will come back in January and again, is that okay?
Yeah,
I'm not gonna. You don't need to commit now, but I will. I'll be having words. Yeah. Okay. So we're gonna have the first of our panel speakers, who's Donna Comerford. She's going to introduce herself while I get her presentation ready.
So I've called this presentation Postcards from the South Coast, simply because we are on the South Coast. And it's snippets and sort of bits of projects that I've been involved with for the last few years. And I just want to tell you all about that and how down here we are using a lot of technology in education, both in the formal classroom and informal ways as well. So, going the right way or not. Yay. Okay, so I've been really, really lucky to work with a lot of people in the area. And listening to my two colleagues before, it's been all about me saying yes to lots of opportunities. So I collaborate with other teachers that I've met in this room at Teach Meets. I've done work with Jacqueline, who's sitting there, Curiosity Hub, she's up there as well. Maker Club, down here. There are so many people around the area who are working in this space with children and technology. It's not just about the computers. So for me, it's all about people collaborating. It's all about teachers just looking up from their massive workload and saying yes. I am back in full-time teaching now. I work over at Backel. But I still try to say yes to a lot of things. So, as part of my work in Eastbourne, I collaborated with Isilda at The Keep in Brighton. They're absolutely awesome. They brought out bits of the collection that we could handle for my Year 7 class, who were working on BAFTA Games design. That is an amazing competition. All the resources are provided for you, and they suggest it will take about 6 hours or something. It doesn't. This project spanned 6 weeks, an hour every week. And once again, the children were really excited by it. They come in their break times. They come in their lunch times because they were building something that was real to them and would go into a national competition. They were incredible at this, and this was Year 7's learning with Scratch. STEM ambassadors. I'm also a STEM ambassador and a serial volunteerer. I'll volunteer for anything. If you give me a goodie bag, I'm there twice. STEM ambassadors, they run out of Brighton University, and every sort of couple of weeks, I'll get an email about something fantastic that's going on and they'd like my help with. If you are interested in technology and you want to go to schools and support what they are doing, please talk to STEM Sussex, become a STEM ambassador. Really, really important for the children. Now, listening to the Connected Classrooms via Google, there are people around, there are educators around who've been doing this for a long time. Quad blogging, also set up by a teacher, which joined four schools in a quad, and I asked my children who I was teaching ICT to be a part of a quad blog, and our schools, we were linked to a school in Canada, a school in Scotland, and another school in England. And they spent time reporting on their projects. So we used it as a sort of communication tool so they could tell people about what they were building, what their aims were for their projects. And then on KidBlog, another child-friendly platform, we did the same thing. So as teachers and educators, we could manage that, keep them safe, and then talk to our compatriots in other countries about comments that the children were leaving, and we could vet them before they finally went live. Really important. Once again, collaboration with other colleagues who met at Teach Meet. I worked with one school, music teacher. Her children came, they walked to my school because they were that close. Her year 10s created the music for two classes of year 7s who'd created their BAFTA Games design. All they had to specify was, I want the sound to be a bit dark, I'd like it to be this long, I'd like it to be like this. And the year 10s on iPads were able to come up with the sounds for those games. And then they just sent us the files. I really think collaboration is the way that technology is used best in a classroom. So it's not just collaboration with our colleagues in different schools. It's, I think, over the last sort of 3 or 4 years, I'm coming to the conclusion that we really need industry to be collaborating with us. If industry, and I'm thinking about Brighton, creative and digital industry, it is the one sort of employing industry in this town that should have more of an input into schools, into education, and support teachers. Sorry, has everyone got shots that they need to? Connective culture. Now, this is a project that was funded by Artswork, who are an arts organization and a charity that works with children and young people to tell them about art, make art accessible for them. Connective culture happened in three towns around Britain. One was Oxford, one was Margate, and one was Eastbourne. I was really happy to project manage the Eastbourne side. So we worked with five schools in Eastbourne, and technology partners were Tech Resort, who were a collection of people working in the creative and digital industries in Eastbourne. There's a lovely, lovely community there. And we had international artists who came and did sessions for us. David Blandy, absolutely amazing. I sort of met him as he was taking his child to school one day and said, David, would you mind? And he said, yeah. You've only got to ask, and a lot of these people will say yes or no, but I know someone who can. Sibley Delisle, Lumen Prize winner, he came onto this project and did a session for us in a school. He's another one. You ring and you say, oh, Seb, have you got time? Would you mind? And he'll either say yes or no, I'm really, really busy. I think a couple of times I've asked him to do things. He said, yeah, where are you? I'll come now. Absolutely amazing. So it's just about the ask for a lot of artists. This project was, the focus of it was about improving the sort of digital creativity and skills in schools to support teachers. And I think the main finding that we found was teachers really want more support and more help. And we'd hoped that the partnerships that we created during this project would continue to last. They have, in a way, but then, of course, teachers get really, really busy, so the relationships drop away. Now, dates for your diary. In my serial volunteering, one of the things that I absolutely love every year is MozFest. It happens on the Greenwich Peninsula at Ravensbourne University. It is a whole weekend of tech. If you go as a volunteer, you get a goodie bag and a t-shirt. I've got loads of t-shirts. You get fed. You give them 4 hours of your time. I tend to go on the Friday night because then on Saturday I can go all day for free. I could go Sunday if I could afford the train fare to go back again. But they had a journalism track for the very first year last year. They have people who've gone to Ghana, to Kenya, to Japan and done development work, maker work, and they come back and they host sessions. It is absolutely amazing for anyone that's interested in tech, in education, in arts, in journalism. It's worth going. I think the tickets are about £45, all volunteering. Year-round Crest Awards, this is STEM Sussex again, engineering education scheme. For the teachers in the room, STEM Sussex, talk to them. If you are teaching Key Stage 5, that's year 12, sixth form, these are all schemes that they can get involved in that will add value when they're writing their UCAS reports, which I've just spent the last 2 weeks involved in. Think about this for them. I know everyone is incredibly busy, but it's worth looking up and just seeing what is out there, what's available. Now, I think that there are a few of us who are working in the space between education and tech and creativity. If we are lucky, we are in schools that allow us that space, that time, to get on board with a lot of projects. They encourage us to do that. Do contact me using Twitter. Talk to other people in the room. There are loads of people here who are working in this space. They are working with children and young people out in the informal learning arena. For your classrooms, provide an environment where they can be creative. Working in Eastbourne as a teacher and a subject leader, I was allowed, or rather, I thought, I'll ask permission, I'll ask forgiveness later, but for BAFTA Games Design, because this thing just went on and on, because the children loved it, I just matched all the assessment criteria to that project. So everything that we needed to do for Key Stage 3, Year 7, ICT, I matched to that project. Then we added in the communication by being in the quad blog. So all the things you need to do can be matched to some of these things. And what I've found recently is that primary schools are very much project workers. They work very much using projects that the children can really get into, pull to pieces, and build something fantastic. We need to foster their curiosity. I love it when children and young people are curious enough to say, well, what would happen if I did this? Or can we do that? I've just recently started an entrepreneurial extracurricular class. And Peter Jones, the dragon, runs this competition, Tycoon in Schools. I think it was on slide 3 or something. And I had a young person, year 7, 11 years old, who said, oh, can I join this club? Because I'm a bit young. I said, we've got 14-year-old millionaires. What do you think? So they've come along and they've been talking about collecting milk bottle caps from the beach, melting them down and turning them into jewelry. They want to call them beach gems. Now, I'm still trying to get them to say what exactly we're going to use these beach gems for, but they're still excited about the process of potentially melting them down. And I said, they're not toxic, are they? They said, oh, we'll check. So they're busy checking those things to make sure that their meltdown will not kill us all. I think for the future, I would like to see more sort of adoption of virtual reality, of AI, all the things that are in the news right now with Amazon creating their virtual stores. Why can't we do this sort of thing in our classrooms? We've got Google Goggles, we've got Google Expeditions, but I want more. I want classrooms across the world to be able to use these things. So, augmented reality. How useful was Pokemon Go? It brought to the attention of everyone what augmented reality was. So we have things that are very faddy, a bit dangerous, but everybody knows about it. Everybody knows what augmented reality is. And I would like to see us using more of it in our classrooms. And that's about it from me. Thank you.
Lynn Cassidy, I'll get your...
dynamic as the rest of the presentation today, so I apologise for that in advance, but I hope you enjoy it. And it's kind of generally about the future of education, the way we kind of see it at Maker Club. So
I head up Impact at Maker Club, which kind of nominally means that I try to make what we do at Maker Club more accessible to as many people as possible. Specifically, I work with low-income families, mainly in the areas that we're based. So Maker Club is based in 4 cities around the UK, and we work with pretty much most of the primary schools in the area, which is it's a really rewarding and exciting thing to do. I'm so happy with what I do every day. We primarily teach children creative technology and design skills. But more simply put, we teach kids how to invent cool stuff. That's some of them inventing cool stuff in there. invention is a naturally cross-curricular process. It can involve coding, design, electronics, critical thinking, maths, history and art all in one project. Children can start with open-ended problems like how would you reduce pollution on your road using an Internet of Things-enabled device? Or how could you redesign an everyday object so it's easier to use for elderly people? Just like real life, solving these problems can't be siloed into individual subjects. It's much broader than that, and also in companies, softer skills like presentation and team working. The kids will work with their groups to conduct research, ideate new possibilities, and produce physical prototypes for testing, much like exactly what you were talking about with the design thinking stuff. So we're just teaching that kind of stuff, but at a little bit earlier age. So hopefully by the time they kind of get to a point later on, they've kind of got those things really embedded in what they do in their personal culture. Even though the outcomes and processes may use technology, it's actually a very human way of learning. The children are working together to solve an actual problem that involves real people. We're in an age where the whole of humanity's knowledge is available free on the internet. It's easily accessible and generally in mediums that are understandable. The bigger question here is why in the 21st century, with all this tech and all this information, are we still even talking about falling literacy rates, lack of STEM provision and overworked teachers? It just doesn't make any sense. While technology is providing all manner of opportunities, the way we learn and teach as a society needs to be updated along with it. Essentially, we need to grow up. I'm going to start talking initially about making a mission, really. So I'm personally a massive sci-fi geek, so I love talking about the future. I love watching stuff about the future. I love reading stuff about the future. I love the utopian ideals of things like Star Trek and the morals questions raised by about technology in films like Blade Runner, things like that. But when you start talking about the future of anything, I think it's sometimes a really good idea to look to the past. I'm going to, kind of wobbly lines, I'm going to take you back into the past here. I'm going to take you back to 1899. This is 1899. We're here now in 1899. We all time travelled. This is just before the opening of the World Fair in Paris. This was a really big deal at the time, absolutely massive. It was, we're about to enter a new century. This is when kind of world fairs were at their pinnacle. So just to give you a bit an idea about how many people visited this. So last year, I think it was 5.9 million people visited the Tate. So the Tate Modern in London. In 1 year, 50 million people visited this. It was huge, it was ridiculous. And obviously it was a way of all the nations of the world kind of showing off their innovation, their technologies, their culture in all kinds of manners of ways. So it probably had a monorail in it. All felt world fairs usually do, but the guys in 1899 had a fantastic idea. So they brought together some of the era's best artists, scientists and thinkers, and they asked them to imagine what the year 2000 might look like. So I'm going to show you a few of these today, but you can go online and see for yourself if you've never seen them, because they're amazing. So this is their imaginings of what's going to happen in 100 years' time. And remember, this was the cleverest minds of the day, so it's really, much, much cleverer than myself and everyone else in the room, really. But... So this was something. This is This is a hair-cutting kit robot up there. It looks incredibly dangerous. I don't think I'd ever get my hair cut by anything like that. I'm not too sure if that's going to happen anytime soon. That's how they're going to fight fires in the year 2000. I don't think I've ever seen one of those before. But in a way, you know, I mean, we've got drones, you know, potentially. You know, there's some kind of link there, but it's still insane, really, isn't it? And then that's my favourite, I think. It's a whale, an underwater whale submarine, which is amazing. I mean, they're incredibly imaginative. They're absolutely brilliant. But like, I think it's kind of proved that sometimes it's very difficult to predict what's coming next, even if you are an expert. But weirdly, I think their prediction for what schools might look like, sadly, kind of nailed it on the head a little bit of what we've kind of got at the moment. So that's what they thought schools were going to look like. And in a funny way, that's kind of what we've got in a very strange way at the moment, you know. So it's kind of like, we've got this information being piled into these kids' brains, which they try to remember then later on for tests. We haven't got the wheel boy that's turning the handle, but that's kind of what's going on right now. Technology is just a tool. We can either use it to work with us to help develop the best things about humanity, or we can put textbooks on iPads. We're basically teaching young people exactly how they've been taught for the last 150 years on a screen that needs to be recharged every 4 hours, making it even less convenient than an actual book. giving learners technology without thinking about how the human culture, about thinking about the human culture around it needs to shift, is a recipe for disaster and disappointment. Rather famously, and apologies if any of you know this story really well, but I thought I'd bring it up anyway. In 1999, Professor Sugata Mitra conducted a very, very special experiment. It's one very close to my heart. His offices were based in Delhi, and like much of the city, they had a slum very close by to where he was based. In fact, he could see it directly from his window. So Professor Mitra and his team concreted, this is 1999, an internet-enabled computer into a wall and watched what happened. The kids that lived in the slum started to learn at an incredible rate. They started to teach themselves using this computer without any kind of facilitators or teachers around them. Without any teachers, they formed their own timetables, small study groups, and worked collaboratively to learn. In their schools, so some of them were going to school as well, the kids were also demonstrating improvements in attendance, concentration, English speaking, and problem-solving skills. Mitra called it minimally evasive education. Sorry. The findings from this study are being replicated and used in educational institutions all over the world, including right here in Brighton as well. So if you've ever heard of the Self-Managed Learning College, which is fantastic, absolutely amazing thing, it uses a lot of these ideas, essentially, which, for example, young people decide what they want to study and learn with the help of a facilitator, creating their own curriculum online and then excelling in it. It has 100% success rate of young people going to work or higher education. We need to trust that as humans, we are already ultimate learning machines. When we find something we like, there's no stopping us. But conversely, if you force people to learn in ways that are not human and do not interest you, you can foster a displeasure in learning anything. Like all good science fiction, future predictions are normally based on ideas and challenges of the time that they're produced. I think predicting the future of learning is much the same. How do we provide a good quality, personalized education to all with reduced resources? How do we encourage a love for learning if it's not being replicated in the home environment? How do we prepare children for a future we know for a fact that we can't predict? Technology can help with some of these things, but it's not inherently valuable. We need to have a radical shift in the way that society teaches young people. So rather than totally predicting things, here's a list of things of what I personally think education needs to be and where we can go from there. I don't think we necessarily need more technology. In fact, I think what we need is to be more human in the ways that we use our current systems. We need to listen to teachers and to develop more grassroots-based approaches, as well as listening to ourselves to understand the best way that we learn. We need to freely share best practice and only do what works. We need an acknowledgement that schools are not the keepers of all information anymore, and that's totally fine, because it's a shared journey. We need education to be highly personalized. We need to trust young people's desire to learn the things that they're interested in. And finally, we need to understand that creativity is perhaps our greatest and most valuable gift that shouldn't be taken for granted. There's the future of learning that we'd like to see, and there's the future of learning that has to be delivered through budget cuts, tired reforms, and overworked staff. It will be hard, and there needs to be more resources allocated, but it needs to urgently happen before we lose a generation. Thank you very much. I can cough now.
Thanks so much, Declan. Next up is Oliver Quinlan.
Right, it's really great to be able to talk to you. I was just thinking as I was listening to those presentations and looked up at a quote that I sort of half remembered from William Gibson, which is, the future is already here, it's just not very evenly distributed. And I think that kind of frames what I'm going to talk about, really. I'm just going to share some examples of some things that I've been involved with in my work over the last couple of years with the Raspberry Pi Foundation. Which is all about digital making things with digital technology, sort of building on the last presentation, really. Lots of people probably know Raspberry Pi as a very low-cost computer that's designed for education, but I work on the Raspberry Pi Foundation side, which is all about getting people involved in learning about computing and digital making. All of the proceeds from the computers funds all of our charity work, which is it's a really interesting place to be, where we're trying to innovate with education and innovate with technological hardware as well at the same time. And all of our work's based around the idea that the world is becoming increasingly digital in some ways, and in other ways, computers or computer-based technology is becoming a tool that is incredibly powerful for more and more problems, for solving more and more problems and challenges that we have. Now, I would definitely caveat that not necessarily all problems, and I think there's some really interesting stuff happening at the moment, particularly politically, that's just showing that technology can cause a lot of problems as well, and isn't necessarily the solution to all of them. But as it gets more and more accessible, more and more powerful, it is becoming something that can be applied to solve more and more problems. And really interestingly for us, it's becoming really accessible for young people to be able to do that and become real sort of agents of change themselves. So I'm just going to start off with a bit of a story of something that I did. I was bought this camera for Christmas a couple of years ago. Really by one of my relatives who I think wanted to make a bit of a joke that because I'm so into modern technology, they'd buy me a piece of old technology. And the idea was for it to sort of sit on a shelf and look nice, really, and probably remind me that brand new tech, shiny tech isn't everything. But I was sort of playing around with this, and I thought, I really want to actually do something with this. It's a really nice bit of technology, but I wonder what I could do with it. So I got a Raspberry Pi computer, one of these Pi Zeros, with a camera module on it, and I fitted it inside that camera. And because the Raspberry Pi is a full-blown computer, you can plug it into a monitor if you want to, you can access the internet and so on. When you start making a project with something like that, your imagination tends to kind of run wild. So I had this camera with a digital camera module inside and a computer. It was very easy to add Wi-Fi to it. It was very easy to add different buttons to do different things. And I actually turned it into a camera that shoots animated GIFs and uploads them to Twitter straight away, which took me quite a long time, actually. Lots of learning from other people and going and looking at sites like Instructables and finding people who'd done little bits of what I wanted to do before and joining those building blocks together and then sort of figuring how it all worked, using some bits I didn't understand very well, finding some more elegant ways to do things. And eventually I managed to make this. And I actually put it to use at my brother's wedding. I haven't got the animated version of this here, but I took it all around the wedding with me and got some really different kind of recordings of what was happening at the wedding with this animated GIF thing. Was, as you can see, this crazy wide-angle lens, which was something I nicked off a kit that I had for my iPhone. So I managed to sort of start off not really at the time, not really knowing an awful lot about programming, to be honest, but just having an inkling of what was possible, grabbing some tools of things that were around me, seeing how they interested me, and then creating something that actually, you know, had some value to me and was involved in events that was really important and really mattered. And that's one of the kinds of things that I think is really incredibly interesting and powerful about digital making and what people are able to do with it. Some people much younger than me are doing projects much more sophisticated than that. This is a boy called Jonathan who came to see some of my colleagues at Raspberry Pi who were at San Francisco Maker Fair. And I doubt he was, he wasn't around when the Game Boy originally came out, but from somewhere he's got an interest in retro video games, and he actually created his own Game Boy made out of wood that actually runs Game Boy games. In fact, it can run games from all sorts of different retro consoles. He worked with his dad on this, obviously had quite a bit of help, but it was something that they were able to learn together, collaborate together, and create. And really incredibly sophisticated. Now, when I was his sort of age, I used to make projects out of wood with my dad. I remember making a Star Trek tricorder out of wood in my dad's garage. It definitely was not like that. The digital tools that are available have really allowed it to, you know, move beyond make-believe in some cases to something that's actually very real. This is a really interesting project. Sorry, this picture's not hugely descriptive, but this was one of the winning entries to the Pioneers competition that some of my colleagues run, which is for teenagers to get creative with digital making, and it has a theme every time. And this one was about, it was called Make It Outdoors. So could they find things that they cared about outdoors? They made a really interesting video, which is quite fun to watch. What they were trying to do was to make something which would allow plants to express their emotions. And they started off with this premise of what if plants had emotions? What would affect those emotions? And they set up a bunch of sensors which they put in the soil and did some quite sophisticated work to figure out how to monitor the things that the plant was going to care about, like light and heat and moisture and so on, and then come up with a way of calculating what mood the plant might be in based on the conditions that were there. And you can see this one displayed on a BBC micro bit there. Was a particularly happy plant with a big smiley face, but other ones, depending on their conditions, were less so. So they were able to do some quite interesting stuff that, you know, okay, it's quite fun and you might seem a little bit frivolous, but they had to look into a lot of things to do with science and to do with programming and to do with electronics hardware to make that happen. This is a great project as well. This is a student at Bourne Grammar School setting off a high-altitude weather balloon. And that weather balloon, this is a fairly well-documented project, although an ambitious one that you can find online, had a small lunchbox attached to the bottom of it with a computer and an antenna and a camera, and went up and took photographs like this. You can actually see the curve of the Earth there. And this was done by, you know, a confident and enthusiastic teacher just using resources from the internet and some relatively cheap hardware and allowing his students to do things which are really quite incredible, you know, to come as close really as is possible for a civilian to actually going into space, which is quite amazing. And this picture was beamed down live, by the way, as well. They have to chase the balloon afterwards as it falls and go and recover the payload to get the full versions of the photos and all of the data. But the thing does actually transmit it live, which is an incredible project. This is a bunch of students from Thirsk School. They did some really interesting science work. They were using computers, Raspberry Pis, with things called sense hats on them as part of a project that we've run, a competition called AstroPi. And they created a science experiment on their computer, wrote all of the code for it, and then it was run by Tim Peake on the International Space Station. So we managed to send two of these computers at with all sorts of, I mean, my colleague learned so much from how to get things into space and all of the compliance that has to happen. Apparently they have a saying that when the paperwork weighs more than the payload, then you're allowed to send stuff up into space onto the space station, but no sharp edges and all sorts of things like that. But we've got these two computers up there, and we've been running these competitions where young people can write code that actually runs on the space station. And they've done some really interesting stuff. So we've had the project that those students made actually displayed, it figured out where the International Space Station was above the Earth and displayed the flag of that country on the screen for the astronauts to see. All sorts of stuff to do there, to do with positioning coordinates and reading databases and all sorts. Some people have done things using infrared cameras to try and detect radiation. My favourite one is one to do the astronauts' perceptions of weightlessness. So the astronaut actually takes the computer, presses a button and closes their eyes, and then pushes themselves forward. And what they have to do is press the button every time they think they've come back to being upright again. And there is an accelerometer and various other sensors in there. So the computer knows how far it has travelled and whether it's upright. And they were comparing the data of the astronauts' perceptions to the hard data from the computer, finding out how that worked, which is fantastic. So running science experiments on the International Space Station, it's cutting edge stuff really that even students are able to do. So those are just a few examples, really powerful ones. As I said, some of them are very ambitious, but they're becoming increasingly much easier. For instance, with the AstroPi competition, we now have a new version called Mission Zero, which guarantees that students can have their code run on the International Space Station. So they can write a program that does something relatively simple, and they can have their code run actually in space. Really incredibly inspiring stuff, and that's the kind of thing that is going to start people's interests. As was said in the previous talk, it's going to get people's interests going and see just how much is possible with technology. And there are so many things that can be achieved with these new tools. There's lots of learning that needs to be done to get there, but with the right kind of inspiration and access to these tools, you can achieve some really quite futuristic things today without having to actually time travel into the future. Thank you.
Right, thank you. And the last of our presentations from Donald Clark.
Could you get my PowerPoint up? I'm just going, yeah. Good evening, everyone. My name is Donald, as in Trump. It's probably the world's most unpopular name. I don't think anybody's going to call their kid Donald from now on. That's a fact. And I'm going to do something slightly different. I'm going to talk, be much more blue sky and talk about real future of technology and education. The reason I'm in Brighton, I'm obviously from Scotland. I've been here for actually longer than some of you born. I came here 30 years ago, started as a e-learning company, flew to the stock market. I'm an entrepreneur, business guy by background. Sold that 2005. I invest in tech companies that do learning. I teach that subject at the university level, and my whole world is wholly involved with these two letters now, because it's my belief that the one thing that will shape absolutely the future of technology and learning are these two letters, and that's artificial intelligence. The first two speakers came from Google, and Google is nothing but an artificial intelligence company. That's what it is. And actually, a piece of artificial intelligence that kicked off was a little equation, a Bayesian equation called PageRank, into the right of your thumb that created a multi-billion dollar company. I think that Google is probably the biggest pedagogic shift in my life. I'm old enough to remember I had a PhD at university. I remember walking up and down the shelves of libraries for weeks and months looking for journals and books. You no longer have to do that, folks. You remember people, some of you can obviously remember those days. So AI, okay, let's come to this one. You may think this is not very relevant to you as teachers, but believe me, it already is. Technology is always ahead of sociology and culture. We're always in catch-up mode, always will be. Live with that one. But pedagogy is always right, even further back. I mean, typically, you know, when I go into university, you know, I'm asked to lecture. I don't like lecturing. I'm asked to lecture. And Plato was lecturing 2,500 years ago, folks. It's exactly the same news. It was 2,500 years ago. Absolutely nothing has changed. Okay? In that front. Very different schools. I don't have to make that accusation to
I think secondary school, primary school teachers are way beyond university. That's a fact. Why does artificial intelligence really matter in learning? Well, first of all, you have to understand what's happening in the world. Artificial intelligence will shape what people, your children, will do in the future for work. It already has. Some of them are elected because of the automation of factory work. We no longer have that, by and large. In the 19th century, everybody worked in the fields. That was mechanized. We all moved into factories. That was automated. We all moved into offices. That's being automated. And these kids have nowhere else to go, folks. This is going to really shape the future of work, which means education has to pay attention to it, because you have to really reflect on what you teach and how you teach it, because the world has changed and will continue to change because of this. If you look at the list of companies over here, that was 10 years ago, by market capitalization globally, ExxonMobil, General Electric, and so on and so forth, by and large, oil companies and banks. Look at the market cap in the biggest companies in the world now in 2016, this data. Apple, Alphabet, which is Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook. These are essentially AI companies. Every one of those tech companies is shaped by AI. If you speak to the chief exec of a tech company, their strategy is to build things in the back of AI. So this will be the future of the world. If you look at the top 10 brands, Google, Apple, Amazon, when you buy things on Amazon, you'll be subjected to AI, Microsoft, Samsung, Facebook, again, many of these companies, AI driven. Top 10 every year, the Boston Consulting Group, among the top 10 most innovative companies on the planet. Almost every one of those is an AI company, including Tesla. You may think it's a car company, but when you sit in a car, it's actually really hanging off the edge of an AI driven network. And it's constantly learning. Every Tesla car learns when you drive it, and that goes back into servers, and every future unborn car is the child of AI. Okay? Now, I'm trying to make this really relevant to you guys in the room here. Whenever you or any one of the people you teach get on a mobile device or a tablet you're using in the car, okay? Who doesn't use Google? Who doesn't use Google? Pure AI. It's been here forever. It's reshaped education. If you use social media, your newsfeed, timeline, and Facebook will be driven by an algorithm. So algorithms also, so you're involved in that one. This is true of Twitter as well. If you buy a book on Amazon, as I just said, you will be influenced by a recommendation engine. And believe me, the stats are really clear. You will have bought books that you would not have otherwise bought, and it's been driven by software, not a human being. If you watch Netflix, believe me, you have watched lots of things that a piece of AI has recommended to you. You may not feel you have, but believe me, the statistics are really clear. That's why Netflix is so successful. It's an AI-driven recommendation engine. So it's everywhere. Your spam filters and email, everything. Everything is mediated by AI. So the new user interface for all your kids, every time they go online, is driven by AI. Except in those awful e-learning programs of multiple choice questions, text, graphic, horrible noisy animation, multiple choice question, then it all falls apart and the kids are going, what the hell is this? Or those horrible little gamified programs, you know, kids play serious games, they come to school and they get this, let's, you know, collect rubies by moving through some crappy 3D maze designed by people who don't really know how to design games. The way to transcend that is to move into a much more serious, smart learning software world, smart software, and that means artificial intelligence. And the new kids on the block in this world are Agent Brin, Google, of course. We have Sebastian Thrun down here, who's built a big group company, it's worth $1.5 million. He was the head of research for AI at Google, who gave us self-driving cars and so on. These are the guys who are shaping the learning landscape as we speak. We have Andrew Nagy and Daphne Kohler, who created Coursera. These are big open online courses. Believe me, there are millions and millions of learners using these courses. They will teach by a factor of 10 or 100 more kids than you'll ever teach in your whole lifetime. This is incredibly successful because it has scale. With the guy in charge of edX down here as well, head of research at MIT, and Simon Kahn, who's a mathematician and AI guy, who came and gave you Khan Academy. And if you've been a maths teacher, I taught maths, believe me, kids use Khan Academy all the time. Actually, first and second year undergraduates in maths degrees use Khan Academy. Okay? And AI has been around for a long time. It's not suddenly came out of nowhere. The first algorithm was written by Euclid, and that was 300 BC. We've had 2,500 years of maths to get here. It's been a long haul, this. A long haul. This is a really important guy down here. This is the guy. Google wouldn't exist without this 18th century of days. But why now? Why am I talking to you about AI right now? Why is it so important now? Well, AI is a bit like a rocket. It didn't have any fuel before. It didn't have any data. We had the algorithms, we had the maths. Suddenly you have a tsunami of data fueling the rocket, allowing it to fly. That's why Google exists. It has millions, if not billions, of users. That's why Facebook flies. It's huge amounts of data feeding its efficacy. We've had big advances in machine learning, companies like DeepMind, and every single one of you learners has a smartphone that could beat the best chess player on the planet. AI smartness is already in the hardware. All this stuff comes together to produce a perfect storm. Efficacy. Okay. Now, to bring this back to the subject of teaching and learning, and I'm talking about learning not just in schools here. I mean, you know, learning takes place throughout a lifetime. You only spend a certain amount of school, a tiny amount of time in college, university, or whatever, and then most of your learning will take place in the workplace or later in life. So let's talk expansively about this. The first thing that AI helps you do is answer questions and find stuff, of course. This is a really interesting little app here that a lot of maths teachers will know about called Photomaths. So Photomaths is a very cool thing. When I learned maths at school, I got homework, I got home, I didn't know the answer, I got stuck. How stupid is that? Because I used to get these A4 sheets of questions in maths that were usually photocopied out of a book somewhere, and if I got stuck, I got stuck. Now, a kid can simply point their mobile at the question to be handwritten. The AI will read the question, interpret the handwriting, and give them the answer. That's why teachers hate it, and why kids love it. Because they really don't want to be doing 20 quadratic equations on a Tuesday night. The truth of the matter is, however, there's a very smart little one called Steps here. You can see here, when you press that, it gives you all the steps between the question and the answer. It's quite primitive at the moment, but it shows you the way this is going. Because that's where all the teaching takes place in maths, having taught maths. You know, it's all to do with keeping that perseverance through from the question to the step until you get to the point. You can do amazing things with this technology in a way you can't with that more traditional AI. Okay, learner support. You may have heard the chat box. You probably use them without realizing it if you're on Twitter. A lot of people, but 10% of people on Twitter you think are real people aren't. They're actually marketing bots. Don't worry, they're a bit benign. They don't do you any harm. But they're already there. You just don't know that they're pieces of software. This space over here is a very famous Microsoft bot called Tay. Kids are really smart. They knew what it was. There was two groups of young people who trained Tay, launched by Microsoft, to become a sex-crazed Nazi. Because they understand what bots are. The Daily Mail went apeshit. Everybody over 50 thought it was the end of civilization as we know it. All it showed was that kids are pretty smart. They know what technology is. They know that bots can be trained. Okay? More to the point, we have bots now. There's an interesting word from China in the middle here. These two bots were launched by Microsoft in China. Millions of young Chinese kids using them, chatting away as if they were companions or friends. That's what these bots do. Until one day, one of the questions was asked, what is the Chinese dream? And the bot came back, the Chinese dream is to go to America. The government got hold of this and shut it down within 4 hours. You've got more to fear from governments than Google or anything, believe me. Cortana, Siri, all these voice-activated things, these are already bots. This is going to be quite big, and let me explain why. So, middle of last year, I got an interesting case study sent to me by my son, who's doing a degree in AI, and it was about a course in artificial intelligence. So these are smart kids at a top university doing this course in artificial intelligence. They've got 9 learning assistants or teaching assistants. You decide to not tell the kids, but swap one of the teachers out with a bot. Okay, they just swapped it out, didn't tell anyone. Not one of these kids guessed it was a bot. Not only did none of the kids guess it was a bot, but we'd come back with answers to questions. They put it up for a teaching award. Now, how weird is that? Now, why do you think they put it up for a teaching award? Any idea? Why do you think all those students would say, wow, that's a brilliant teacher?
Because it gave them the answers.
It gave them the answers, but it gave the answers quickly. Yeah. I don't know, for those who've been at university and never emailed a tutor, or waited on a mark on the essay that you submitted? Did it come back in minutes, days, hours, weeks? So this thing was coming back so quickly they had to put a delay mechanism in. They actually had to slow it down to make it look like a real teacher. Not only did it come back with the answer super quick, not only was it super quick, it didn't have that slight sarkiness you get. And believe me, in the computer science department where I spent a lot of my time, let's just say that the teachers, maybe there's not a paucity of social skills. And really, these guys, they're lying large guys, come back to students going, you're a second year undergraduate. Why do you know this thing in algebra or whatever? It's unbelievable the things they say, because they don't have that empathy in a way. The good thing about bots in AI is it doesn't care. It doesn't know that I'm a guy, a woman, gay, anything. It doesn't know anything about me. It's just completely non-interested in all that stuff. You know, it just delivers the goods. And one of these in my kitchen is an Amazon Echo, loads of these things you can now buy here. And it sits in my kitchen because when I get up in the morning and make my coffee, I can just say, Alexa, BBC Radio 4, it plays Radio 4. I listen to the Today programme, I get pretty fed up that quickly. But what I have managed to do is switch it over to talking German to me. Now, I tell you this because, having been involved with language learning in schools in the past, there are tens of thousands of young people sitting and they'll spend 5 to 8 years learning a language, which will be German, Spanish, Italian or French, and they'll be barely able to ask for a cup of coffee at the end of the 8 years in that country. It's an area of catastrophic failure. Because English is so dominant in the world, that's one reason, and we don't get the real immersion we need. I actually have a German person in my kitchen that I can talk to. That's how you learn languages. You do not learn languages from the multiple choice questions in your learning programs. Neither do you really learn a language in the classroom. Because a tiny number of people sit in doing those French and German lessons year after year will actually master anything in terms of usefulness in the language. So we have to get away from this idea that the only British will learn this stuff. If you look at other things we can do here on the learning front, this is a company I've been involved in and started a year and a half ago. It will take any course notes, textbooks, PowerPoints, videos, you put it into an AI engine and it creates e-learning automatically. Touch of a button. All the design work, all the questions. It uses semantic analysis to analyze the text, understand what the main learning points are, and build the e-learning from it. No multiple choice questions, completely defeat the thing entirely. This is the way good online content for learning will be created in the future. This is the big one, however. So I think we heard somebody talk about personalization earlier. You know, Google is highly personalized. When you start typing that stuff in, it actually knows what you're after and is making guesses all the time until it comes up with the answer for you, in a sense. Almost all the services you use are personalized for you. Netflix, Amazon, Facebook, Twitter, I can go on and on and on. Why isn't education personalized? Having taught 30 kids in a room maths at one point in my life, believe me, you have absolutely no idea what's going on in the heads of those 30 kids at any time when you're teaching them. Not a scoop. It's impossible. And maths is one of those subjects where there are loads of things that can go wrong cognitively. Even adding two double-digit numbers together, there's about 20 ways you can go wrong cognitively on that. It's impossible to diagnose that. So the promise here is to do what Google and others are already doing, and that is have a really smart bit of software that's constantly like a sat-nav. Like if I were to drive from here to Dodgers Hill, I'd take the wrong route, and sat-nav gets me back up, pieced again. The idea is to do that in learning. So I have a very, very smart machine learning tool sits behind some of these systems, and this one in particular. Maths is taught like this. It's a linear curriculum, and if you fail at one point, it's catastrophic. Maths is one of those subjects where if you just don't know this, you just don't know anything from then on. You really fall off the conveyor belt, a lot of kids do. Maths is really like this. It has lots of complicated dependencies. It's a network of learning competencies. So you really have to break the knowledge on almost any subject down into a network and allow individual learners to vector through that content in a way that suits them. Some will be slower and take more steps, some will zoom through quite quickly, but each learner will, by and large, be fairly unique. And so they'll zip through these networks with this sort of sat-nav software, which is incredibly clever. Not only is it clever, it learns. The more people who use this system, the smarter it gets. The smarter it gets, okay? And if you don't think this works, then it's already been used in scale with hundreds and tens of thousands of students. In the, it's a shame nothing's happening in Europe here. The Americans are miles ahead of time, but Arizona State, you have really big increases in success rates. And these are in courses like history, American history, biology, maths, a whole range right across the curriculum. And on the very first large-scale trial, this, the attainment scores went up from 76-78% to 94%. That doesn't sound like much. Believe me, if you achieved that in your school, you'd be published. You know, you'd be taken down the street and celebrated. These are amazing increases in attainment, real dog bites. And of course, what you get when you get an increase in attainment is an absolute statistical correlation, because you get far less dropout. And dropout's a big problem in American colleges, and the rate of dropout in America, in British universities, has been going upwards as well as kids have been going to university. The group, the sort of yellow and blue things are feedback from students. Do they like this stuff? Well, when it's smart, when it's like Google, they do. And that's what this stuff is. It's smart. It seems smart to them, like the Georgia Tech teacher. It behaves like a teacher. It's not, don't worry, it's not going to be replacing you anytime soon. This is all enhancing of teaching. Good teachers make this stuff work incredibly well. It's not replacing teachers. But what it is doing is taking the workload of teachers. That's the plan. Okay, what about assessment? Well, this is a big meme on Facebook, I'm sure you've seen. If only I had a few more papers to grade, said no teacher ever. In my experience, especially at Christmas time and holidays. And of course, the one area where AI can help you is surely the automation of marking and testing. It drives me crazy when I hear teachers complaining about marking, and yet this technology, because it's the one solution to that problem. It's actually fairly straightforward in many ways. It's one of the easy nuts of cracking this area. We even at MIT and Harvard have automated essay marking. You may think that's impossible, but if you feed these AI engines with 100 essays, it becomes as good as a human marker. In fact, it becomes slightly more objective. Essay marking is a really weird thing in teaching. And the study shows some really weird anomalies. In other words, you tend to mark, you know, the third and fourth essay, you start marking down as you start marking them. The mark you give this essay very much depends on the mark you give in the essay below. If you know the name of the person, you will have absolute bias on race and gender in terms of your marking. This is all well established, which is why it should be anonymized, and hardly ever is, of course. But actually, to really anonymize this stuff, you should be thinking about using this, because by and large, this sort of stuff gets rid of human bias. You're all sexist, you're all racist, you have about 50 other cognitive biases. You can read Kenyon's book if you want to know what they are, confirmation bias, negativity bias. By and large, AI can get rid of those. That's not to say that AI is not biased. Human, yet all human beings are biased. Some algorithms are biased. Important distinction here. And of course, we have the possibility now of online assessment, so you've got to think of those there. Then you do a type test and notes from the speed at which you type that paragraph, a unique fingerprint. So those are involved, so that when I come to sit the exam, the paper knows it's gone to type. That's a piece of AI. But it's also doing face recognition now, so it knows I'm Donald, not my smart brother or something. They're now doing real-time face recognition, which spots whether you're cheating or not, because it's got sentiment now. So some really clever things happening regarding assessment and online marketing. Okay? So it's not that this stuff's going to replace you guys nowhere soon. And forget that stuff about robot teachers. The idea of a robot teacher is ridiculous as having a robot driving a self-driving car. It's not the point. People think that AI is all about robots. It's about hardly anything to do with robots, to be honest. Google's not a robot, to be solved. But these are all the things it does, you know? AI never sleeps. It never gets angry, it doesn't have to take holidays. It's 24/7, 365 days a year. It gets better and better and better the more you use it. It's got scale. And it never dies. Interesting. Even when you're long gone, it will still be getting better and better. So this is absolutely the future. I'm going to end on something quite worrying here. Because the Todai robot project is not actually a robot project, but it is a project in Japan where they set a suite of AI tools. Pass, which was to pass the entrance examination to Tokyo University. And it passed it. In fact, it scored higher than most of the other students who actually got into Tokyo University. It's the most difficult exam in the Far East. And it's English, physics, maths, all sorts of subjects. Why did we do this experiment? And it's quite worrying in a way, because if AI can already have those graduate level skills at entry into university, you'll be damn sure that not 3 or 4 years later, but probably 3 or 4 weeks later, it has the skills of a graduate on exit. Okay, it's as smart as graduates going in. Why on earth is it not going to be as smart as graduates coming out on narrow tasks? And this is a worry, because many of the tasks that we are teaching our kids to do in the future, not so much in primary and secondary schools, where it's a generic education, but certainly in colleges and universities, are under threat here. In America, we have tens of thousands of lawyers piling into the market, and there are no longer the law jobs there. Why? Because laws like the pyramid, the bottom half of the pyramid has been automated, just like blue-collar factory workers were automated when robots went in. Okay, so this is really scary stuff, this, which is why we as educators, I think, should step up to the plate, because it's a bit like the Godiva AI. It destroys, but it can also do wonderful things. I think it's probably the only chance we've got of solving complex problems like climate change and so on. But it's also possibly the real solution for the big needs we'll have in being flexible, scalable, and much cheaper around education. I'm always pleased to add a couple of things. I'm always pleased when I come to college, because one of the things that's going to change is this ridiculous obsession with theory we have, the idea that we should be sending every kid to university to do 3 or 4 years and walk out with a £50,000 debt round the neck. I have twins, that was quite expensive. The future for people with vocational skills is quite bright. We had hairdressing as an example. I always love it when I walk by the hairdressers here. I was a trustee of Satan Gills for a number of years. Because believe me, there's no way soon that a robot is going to be cutting any of the way. By the way, AI, don't get too carried away with it. It's a bit of an idiot savant. So I'll illustrate this by example. I bought one of the very first vacuum cleaners in AI. It was terrible. Just shit. It was terrible. And then I got a new one, and actually it's super smart. It actually knows what my house is. It maps out the rooms. It can move from room to room. When it runs low in battery, it goes back into the docking station. Mathematically, absolutely superb. Okay, huge labor-saving device. But famously, I have a problem. The famous example is a dog comes along, there's a shit on your carpet. It smooths it throughout the carpet, mathematically, into every single corner. And you'll be gagging for days while you clean it up. AI is profoundly stupid. It's an idiot, but it's really smart with narrow task stuff, which is why it won't replace teachers soon, because you're a generalist. You can cope with behavioural problems, all sorts of things with kids. But it does narrow things superbly well. And this is our opportunity to get rid of the admin, the marketing, all that work you don't want to do as a teacher. Most of the time you're not teaching, most of the time you're doing admin. It works out about 50% of your job. Why would you want to do that? Why would you not want to teach? And that's, of course, what kids want from you as well. So I think we have a bright future here. If we grab the opportunity, perhaps we as educators are on the forefront of this revolution, as opposed to finance or other areas of endeavor who are already doing this. And I think if that's the case, then some wonderful things can be achieved. Okay, thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
Very much to the speakers. If you can come up, we've left a tiny bit of time for some questions.
But it's been great. It's been inspirational. I think we'd all agree. Listening to the panel, we've got 20 minutes with some questions from the floor. I'll sit in the middle if that's all right, Oliver. Thank you. So, is there anyone who's got any questions? Anyone who's got any questions that they'd like to ask from the floor about the future of education and maybe not niche questions on the stuff you've heard, because I think the guys will be around afterwards and can chat with you. But has anyone got any questions, or shall I go for some of the questions that we've been given, we've been fielded online? Do you want the mic?
Schools. I think we know it's So there's a real tension between what educators know we need to do to develop, but politically, I think even what a few of the speakers have talked about tonight, the challenges of transforming education in our society seems to be huge. You know, I'm lucky. I teach a course that's got no exams.
Is this a question, Jim?
Is this a question? How do we get the message across? How do we start to change things?
What you're saying is, the question is, there's, with the massive tension that's evident between the system as is and the kind of stuff that we've heard everybody talk about tonight, how do we navigate and how do we overcome that? Who wants to go with that?
I'd be happy. Yeah.
I've got problems chairing you, aren't I, Donald?
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. But this is a subject close to my heart. I'm 60 years old. I've been in the Labour Party all my life. And one of the things that has shocked me over the last 5 years, actually the last 10 years, is the way in which the left actually encouraged this. Because in practice, the recent levy, which employers will pay, giving kids a chance. Remember, the majority of kids in our country do not go to university. If any Labour politician steps on our screens, all they talk about is student fees for university kids. It's a disgrace. So I like coming to this college and passing the hairdressing kids here, because they've been abandoned by both the Labour Party and the Conservative Party for decades. Curiously, the apprenticeship levy was brought in by a right-wing Conservative government. This is totally and utterly bizarre. So successive Labour governments literally abandoned those kids, literally abandoned them, stripped the funding out of vocational learning for decades, and it was up to a Conservative government to start to solve the problem. So I don't buy this notion that, you know, this is... The political waves come and go, as it were. I don't think they really fundamentally affect the nature of teaching and pedagogy in schools, other than, of course, the horrific testing regimes.
Yes, totally bang on. But I'd also say that it's happening whether governments want it to happen or not. Like, I mean, you know, for example, over the last kind of, I think it's just last 4 years, we've seen like a 16% rise in homeschooling. You know, there's schools over in the US in San Francisco, obviously the place where the kind of newest, most innovative things happen first, called Alt School. If anyone's ever heard of that before, it's a school powered by AI. So essentially, you know, you've got sessions where kids log into their own learning dashboard. They're given things called cards, which are essentially tasks or activities that the kids could do. Those cards are picked by teachers at the start of the month, the things they could improve on, things they could get better at. And those cards are actually designed by AI. And then the children learn what they want to learn, when they need to learn it, and they plan out their own week, and they learn, when they need to learn. Those kind of ideas are quite high level, and of course it takes a long time to kind of filter down into everyday stuff, but it's going to happen, whether governments like it or not. But it might just take a little bit longer.
Oliver, Donna?
I think teachers sharing things that they're doing, and not just teachers but educators of all sorts, is really important. And that's difficult because of the time and energy constraints that everyone has. But, you know, I agree with what Donald says, that people can achieve things, and the more that they share that and share the effects that it's having, then the more things move forward, I think. And there is a lot of potential, and the more that you can show things that genuinely make a difference, because there's a lot of innovative teaching practice using technology that is very exciting and interesting, but doesn't make a huge difference at the end of the day. So the more we can be reflective about what makes a difference, share that, encourage others to take it on, it makes it very difficult for people to argue with it if you're demonstrating something that is genuinely making a positive difference.
And I think just to add to that, I'm currently teaching BTEC business studies in an independent school, and the children are working on creating and producing business events. And we've gone with, they've chosen what events they're going to produce. I mean, it's given me a bit of a nightmare. I've got 19 events that I have to sort of keep an eye on. But I know that when they go to university or to work or to somewhere else, they will have the skills to actually create an event like this. They can actually do, they're fit for purpose. And for me, having worked for many, many years. It's important that the children who leave my care are fit for purpose, because I've worked with people who are not that good at their job, regardless of them having been to university, 15 million A-levels and all the rest of it. So I think it's really important that there is a resurgence of the vocational courses, and the value in those things needs to be seen, especially when universities are saying, we've got young people in here, they can get A stars, but they can't actually communicate, they can't work in teams, they can't do this. So I think definitely vocational, big winner for me.
Okay, thanks to the panel for that. Just moving on to a question which you've touched on. Okay, no, step one from the floor.
Yeah.
I think that links to the question I was about to ask, that I think that Donald touched on, in terms of the changing, you know, Donald reassuring us that the role of the teacher, you know, is still necessary, and what are the potential, what different roles will we as educators play in the future? And I think that links into what you're saying there, isn't it? That's maybe one of the key roles that we need to take as educators. So what do the panel think are If we're saying teachers, some teachers will be replaced, well, so that's one question. Will some teachers be replaced, and what roles might be taken in the future? What is the changing role of the teacher, I suppose? Donald.
I think we have to be a bit careful with this one. Because, you know, private sector bad, public sector good. People just talking past each other. Like, I've worked on both sides of that fence, and it can be incredibly destructive, the over-politicisation of one side. And I'm not too sure it is the job of teachers to criticise capitalism, for example, and or to be over-politicised on it, you know. And I think the general critical skills you're needed to examine them, but also critical skills to examine bad public sector organisations might be in order as well. And so I agree with the general values thing here. But we have to, and I agree about the taxation thing on, I know we've got a couple of Google evangelists here, but it's absolutely appalling morally what these companies are doing in ripping away the taxation base across European countries and not paying for education. That money should be spent on education and health, and it's not. It's going into the coffers and the balance sheets of those companies. So be careful with them, I would agree. However, I think in my experience, though, it can turn tip easily. I know I'm not accusing you of being guilty. It can so easily turn into, even before I turn up, I know people hate me because I work in the private sector. You know, when I go into, I teach in universities, believe me, when I lecture, because I'm a business guy, I know that faculty don't like me before I've turned up. So I think you've got to be really careful about over-egging that one as well, you know, if you get my drift.
Yeah, I didn't say that.
No, you did. Yeah, I agree.
Changing role of the teacher educator.
I'll take that one. I think that if, as teachers, we get more involved with the communities that our children are in, the communities around our schools, then there is more sort of chance that we can help those communities to grow and for them to be taking action. I worked with Tech Resort in Eastbourne. That was just a collection of people working in the digital industries who said, look, we want to grow the industry in Eastbourne, which is famed for senior people, it's seafront and all the rest of it. But they have a growing tech industry there because the local people said, look, we want to do this. We're not waiting for government. We're not waiting for local government to do something. We are going to do this. They get involved with the children and young people in the town. And the Devonshire Collective, which is a new sort of project going on, is running Tech Resort Teens, which started off after the project that I ran in 2014. But teachers need to be involved in the communities in which their children live. They need to be supporting them to take action in their communities. I really do think that is a way that we get beyond waiting for government to change things.
And I think those are the human skills that we need people to be focusing on, and not the things that can be replaced by AI, as Donald said in his presentation, things like marking. What I think we have to be a little bit careful of is that those uniquely human things that we can work on are quite challenging and are quite hard work, and it can be quite tempting to go back to spending quite a lot of time on the other things. I know whenever I'm feeling particularly cognitively challenged, then there's nothing better than just going into a spreadsheet and sort of changing a few numbers and doing something really laborious, because it's hard to do the other things. And those easier things are going to be, pardon me, having a Theresa May moment.
got no lozenges, I'm afraid. I can offer you water.
Thank you. But yeah, those human skills are hard. It's about applying the resource of teachers into the best kind of area, and it sounds very attractive on the face of it. So no more marking and go and work at joining up your communities. You know, it's going to be hard work, but ultimately it's going to be the work that makes the big difference, I think, to young people. Teachers working on those uniquely human things supported by technology to do the things that it can do.
Just to add something to go back to your question, because I think what you meant, and I've absorbed it, was this notion of teaching human values, let's say. Okay? And you may imagine that machines could never do that, and it's always a profoundly human thing. But I had a real epiphany recently. I was in the States University of Pennsylvania, and there are three big research studies showing, massive studies, longitudinal studies, that show that diversity training doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Millions, billions have been spent on decades on diversity training, by and large in classrooms from flip charts and so on. It just doesn't work at all. In fact, it's slightly counterproductive. Recently, I saw a really amazing experience on racial training and diversity using VR, where there was a gender swap experiment where if you wore a VR headset, I wore one, you have an avatar of a man, I have one of a woman, and I experience what you're experiencing, and I experience what you're, and then sexual harassment being taught by going into 3D environments where you really do experience it as a man. That was shocking, because you really experience that stuff experientially. And in the racial training one, there was a race swap example, and I did this. And it was designed for example, let's say, what is it like to be a black kid who's stopped every 4 hours because they have a car in Los Angeles, you know? That's an important thing to understand if you're a white cop in Los Angeles. It's also important for a black kid to understand what it's like as a white cop who feels his life's threatened. And you experience that through experience, not in classrooms. So I think there are some human value stuff that can be taught well by this in a superior fashion to the old fashioned. And when we say human, what we mean normally is a classroom. And I'm not too sure that's always the best solution for somebody, even the value stuff. I see what your question is. It was about values general.
Yeah. Declan, do you want to come in? And we've got a question from the floor.
Just briefly, I was going to say, we're starting to merge Google Classroom into what we're doing, into the way we teach technology to kids, and we're a big fan of using Google Docs and doing all the stuff that was spoken about earlier on. But I think there is a legitimate concern to say that, you know, Google is not doing these things completely altruistically. You know, it's not like they're doing all this stuff for free just because, hey, we've got loads of money and we want to educate the world. I mean, there's going to be an element of that, certainly. You know, their motto is don't be evil, you know, of course. But they are getting young people to become Google consumers from day dot. That's what they want. You know, they want you to buy into that, the Google Home, the Google Doc, whatever it is. You know, and they see that child getting 8 years old, or whenever they start using Google, to be a lifelong customer. And there are algorithms that work that out as well, you know, and how much that customer's worth and in advertising revenue and all the other stuff. So I think what you're saying is valid completely. And where the role of the teacher is, I'm kind of viewed on. I don't necessarily think it's their place necessarily to kind of pass their own idea or morality around that specifically. But I'm verbatim just saying you're right to think about that. I think.
Take a question from the floor at the back.
Where do you feel, as a country, we are in the world as far as AI is concerned? Because we've had some lovely projects here today, and they do tend to be isolated pockets of really lovely projects going on. And as we said, there was some that were saying, you know, in four cities in the country, this is happening, that's happening. But as a country, I don't think we're on the world stage with everybody else. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on whether you feel we are or where you think we are as far as that is concerned.
Thoughts? I'm waiting for Donald.
So there are two separate things. If you talked about AI generally, the UK is absolutely right up there in the top. The US is absolutely dominant in this, but there are huge pockets of interesting activity, even in places like Australia. But generally, AI research is absolutely top-notch in the UK. That's generally acknowledged. AI learning, we have probably a bigger concentration of AI-driven learning companies, but we have the lowest usage in educational institutions. All the action is in the US and China, and interestingly, increasingly in Russia. And there are reasons for that. And it comes back to a little bit, this is not addressing you, but back to the issue I was saying earlier. We have, by and large, you know, completely state-funded education at all levels. And there is a culture, there is a genuine culture of there's a very famous essay on this, why do all academics hate capitalism? They all hate capitalism. It's completely skewed with regard to the normal distribution in the population. There is an anti-corporate ethos in education in the UK. It's a real tangible thing. When I was a governor for many years in a comprehensive school here in Brighton, I felt it. I felt it strongly, you know. People who didn't know me didn't like me. And so I think that anti-corporate thing stops us sometimes from making the progress we could. Now, I work in the States a lot. I've lived there. I went to university there even. And it's slightly different there. The university system, for example, is much more open to the outside world than British universities. And even in schools, you know, I ran major businesses, and I was a governor in school and offered my services frequently in business studies. Not once did they ever let me in. Because there was that complete, the school gate, private sector people on the other side of the divide. And I think that's a shame. Because a lot of good teachers would like it. I actually place a lot of the blame on senior leadership sometimes for this in schools.
I think maybe you might want to think about more critical thinking and all this that we're saying as teachers we want to do with our students. Actually, we need to take a step back from that and say, actually, you know, we need to have the grounding there in the first place to be able to then, and I quite agree, corporate is probably the way to go, but it's people taking that first step, isn't it, and encouraging them into doing that, and not many people will take that leap of faith.
And I think, as Donna said earlier, it works both ways in terms of there could be more involvement from, obviously Donna's offering his services, and I know that we have got lots of links with tech and creative businesses, but there is definitely scope for more collaboration from both sides. I'm well aware that we've gone over time, and that people might need to go. I mean, I think people will potentially be hanging around. Oliver he's got to travel the longest distance.
Yeah, I've got to.
So I think we should close it. Maybe we can ask any additional questions afterwards. I would just like to thank the panel very much. I think we would all agree that. And our speakers from earlier, I have found it. I've found it personally inspirational. I expect that's been the same for everybody, from the international hangouts to the empathy maps,
to the projects that Donna was sharing. We've been to space. We went to Burgess Hill at one point with Donald, but also had our minds expanded, and with the work that Declan's doing. Declan, you tackled the man flu there, and you attended, which most of our students would not have done. So big thanks to all of you for attending. I'd like to thank specifically in the organisation of this, Jim Lee, Rachel Thomas, Marion Harrison, and Ty Knight, who put lots of work into organising this event. You will be contacted after this event because it's been part funded. We are running a Google project trying to create a Google community for further education and trying to work with that tech. So you will be contacted after this event because it's part of our, so please do feedback. It's part of the us evidencing the reach of the project. So that's the boring stuff out of the way. Thank you. We will be looking forward to seeing you at the Teach Meet. Anyone who wants to come to speak at the Teach Meet, it's a particular format where you speak for 2 minutes or 7 minutes from memory. Donna's done a few here. Yeah. I almost threw a seagull. Do you remember you used to throw when people went on too long? we'd encourage you to attend that. If you'll notice, it's a bit of a Back to the Future mistake. It says 2017 on the flyer. Disregard that. It was just trying to catch you out. If you put that into your Google calendars, it will stay there and remind you on the day. So thanks very much for everybody. Really, really enjoyed it. Thanks.